Please stand, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of Brent and Hannah and their families, welcome. It's good that you're here, and I'm sure they're happy for your support. Let's pray together. Our gracious God, this day our prayer is that you would bless Brent and Hannah. We ask as well, Lord, that through this ceremony you would make yourself known to all who are here. Lord, help us not to be passive observers, but to be involved in such a way that we may even grow in our relationship with you. Lord, may you be honored in this ceremony. Grant this, we pray, in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated. Beautiful day. As Brent and Hannah are united in marriage, they realize marriage not only joins them, but it also joins their families. Realizing this, Brent and Hannah would like to include their parents in this special ceremony by asking for their parents' blessings and acceptance of this marriage and their spouse into each other's families. So with that said, Nick and Nancy Groenenberg, do Brent and Hannah, have your blessing on their marriage, and will you welcome Hannah into your family as your new daughter? That's the right answer. Phil and Jan Barker, do Brent and Hannah likewise have your blessing on their marriage? And will you welcome Brent into your family as your new son? Brent and Hannah, this is your day, and what a joy it is for all of us to be here with you to share in this really special day. You know, a special day, we put that on a lot of different things, don't we? There's all kinds of events. We call them special days. There's the birth of a child. There's a baby's first step, the first haircut, losing your first tooth, maybe the first day of school, getting your driver's license, the first date, the first kiss. And how about that special day when he came to your house and kneeled down and said, "Will you marry me?" And you said, "I will." And then you cried. And he wondered if they were good tears or sad tears. We weren't sure which. But that was certainly a very, very special day. And these are all certainly special moments. But I believe that today is the most special of all days. Because today you make a lifelong pledge to be faithful
to one another in the most sacred of all relationships, and that is the marriage relationship. This is the most special of all days because we believe God created the home, don't we? And we believe that God created the marriage relationship and that He ordained before the beginning of time that you two would unite on this day, here in this place, and it wouldn't be raining. He knew that. This special ceremony or this special relationship, the Lord refers to it as a great mystery. And the reason it's such a great mystery is because when God created the marriage relationship, it was created to be a picture of the Lord and His relationship with His people. And so it's very, very important. The vows that you will make to one another in a few moments will have a ripple effect on all that will be around you for years to come. The results of your commitment to one another will make a difference for God's kingdom. That's what I'm telling you. What you will do in a few moments is so very important, which is why we've spent so much time talking about it, haven't we? We did, a lot of time, about what it is to be in a godly marriage. And before you say your vows to one another, I just want to share four things with you. It's really four things that my wife and I came up with. Four things that have helped us to make it through 40 years of marriage and really has helped us to make it through some of the tough times. The first one would be this. We would encourage you today to make a decision what kind of statistic you're going to be. My wife and I said it this way. We said we refuse to become a statistic. And what we meant was is we would refuse to become a divorce statistic. That's what we were really saying. And this is biblical, by the way, because Mark 10:9 says, what God has joined, let man not separate. I know it's hard for you to imagine this today, because today you're just so in love. But what we would encourage you is never even entertain the idea. Never talk about, never use it as some kind of a threat or something because you're angry. Never use that word, divorce. You know, make a commitment today that you're going to make this work no matter what would come your way. Secondly, we would tell you to make sure that you keep the Lord in the center of your relationship. Now, I understand that's what a lot of people say, but it's something you have to commit to on a daily basis. Don't allow the philosophies of this world to pull you away from your first love. Matthew 6:33 says, but seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be added to you as well. Now, how do you do this? What I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to say, yeah, I know this, but it's something you have to be aware of. Brent, you're madly in love with this girl, aren't you? Yes, that's the right answer, by the way. But I want to tell you this, Brent. You need to be more in love with the Lord than you are with Hannah. Now, those two work pretty well together, but you've got to be careful to make sure you always keep your eyes on the Lord. And then your love for Hannah comes after that. And Hannah, you need to make sure that you love the Lord more than you love Brent. And I know that's probably kind of difficult on this day because you love Him so much, right? Mm-hmm. But I know you love the Lord too. In other words, the Lord always needs to be in the center and number one in your relationship. Pay attention to what's most important in life. Matthew 6:19-24 says, do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The Bible says you can't serve two masters. You will either hate the one and despise the other, you'll be devoted to one and hate the other. So the idea being is you've got to keep your eyes on the Lord and make sure you always do that. Thirdly, we would encourage you to make sure you honor God's order for the marriage relationship. We've talked about that. This is, in my opinion, the most single violated principle in marriage today. Hannah, God intends you to be Brent's helpmate, to stand alongside of him. In Ephesians chapter 5, verses 22-24, the Lord would be speaking to you, and I'm going to make it personal by putting your name in. Listen to what he would say. Hannah, submit to Brent as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also, Hannah, you should submit to in everything to Brent. And what that means is, basically, is you just help him to be all that God wants him to be. You just stand by him and you help him. That's not hard to do, is it?
No.
Brent, God intends you to be the spiritual leader of your home, offering love, security, and protection to Hannah. Ephesians 5:25-31, if I was to write it personally to you, or if I was to read it personally to you, this is what the Lord would be saying to you from his word. Brent, love Hannah as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of the water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. In the same way, Brent, you should love Hannah as your own body. He who loves his wife loves himself, for no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. Brent, as the man, you were ordained by God to care for this beautiful lady that he is giving you today. You provide security to her. You don't lord over her, and you know that. You love her as Christ loved the church. And then finally, the fourth thing, we would encourage you to protect your inner circle. And we talked about the inner circle. We call it the inner circle in our church. Ephesians 5:31 says, therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. Something changes today in your lives. All these people, all these wonderful people that are here that love you, they're still going to be in your life. But you're no longer single. And so now all of a sudden, those folks, they revolve outside this inner circle that the two of you are in. And it's very important that you understand that all those other relationships, as important as they are not near as important as the marriage relationship to the Lord. And so this is what I said to you. Any relationship, and I hope this never happens, but any relationship that puts itself in conflict with the marriage relationship must lose to protect that which is most precious to God, and that is the marriage relationship. I've been around your families a bit. I don't think it's going to be a problem. But you make sure you protect your inner circle. I want you to know this couple's in love. It's very apparent to me, and I know it's apparent to you. They love the Lord, and they should be together. With that said, Brent, do you promise that you will live with Hannah according to God's purposes? Do you promise to commit yourself to meeting her needs, physical, emotional, and spiritual? Do you promise that whatever the circumstances, whatever comes your way, whether in good times or in bad, you will love, honor, and sustain her? And Brent, look at my eyes. As long as the Lord should choose to give you life, do you promise to him and to her that you will be faithful to Hannah?
I do.
Hannah, do you promise to live with Brent according to God's purposes? Do you promise to commit yourself to meeting his needs, physical, emotional, and spiritual? Do you promise that whatever the circumstances, whatever comes your way, whether good times or in bad, that you will love, honor, and sustain him, and that as long as you shall have life, as long as the Lord should choose to give you life, Hannah, you will be faithful to him?
I do.
I need the rings. Give your bouquet to set these down here. No, just stay facing me. The ring is a material symbol. It's been designed to illustrate a spiritual truth. A ring has two characteristics which make it suitable as a reminder of the importance of keeping Christ in the middle of your marriage. First, the ring is a circle. It never ends. Christian marriages should never end. Marriages should never end. God never intended them to ever end except through death. Difficult times will come, but the commitment of Christians is to make their marriage go on forever. The ring, which is a circle, is a reminder of that never-ending commitment. Second, rings are made out of precious metal, usually silver or gold, and has the unusual quality of getting better with time. That's what happens in good marriages. As much as you are in love here today, I want you to know with each passing day, you should fall more and more in love. That's what the rings symbolize. Join hands and face each other. Brent, will you give your ring to Hannah as a sign of your Christian commitment to her in marriage? If so, say, I will.
I will.
Hannah, will you give your ring to Brent as a sign of your Christian commitment to him in marriage? If so, say, I will.
I will.
The ring is like a string around your finger. It reminds you of something. Every time you look at it, you will be reminded of this day. And everybody that's married understands that. I remember, when I look at my ring, I remember the day that my wife and I were married. It reminds me of that day. That's what these rings are all about. So with that said, Brent, repeat after me. I give you this ring.
I give you this ring.
As a sign of our love.
As a sign of our love.
And commitment.
And commitment.
Man, that is a beautiful ring in the sun. Hannah, repeat after me. I give you this ring.
I give you this ring.
As a sign of our love.
As a sign of our love.
And commitment.
And commitment.
Let's pray together. Lord, Brent and Hannah are precious to you. And as they begin their lives together as husband and wife, we ask that you would help them to make you the foundation of their marriage. We pray, Lord, that they will look to you, that you would provide them with the daily strength and refreshment they need to honor you in all that they do. We do pray sincerely, Lord, that you would protect them from the evil one. You would protect them from this world that will work tirelessly to break them up. May their marriage be so strong, Lord, that nothing would dare come between them. They love you, Lord, and I pray you would use them to take your kingdom to a world in such need of the saving grace of Jesus Christ. Bless them, Lord, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Brent and Hannah, as a pastor of the gospel of Christ, I'm sorry, it always gets me. And more importantly, just as your friend, it is my great joy to say that you are now husband and wife in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. What God has joined, let no man separate. Brent, you may kiss your bride. Turn around and face the audience. Give her okay back. Hannah. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my great pleasure to present to you for the very first time, Mr. and Mrs. Brent Groenenberg.
Thank you.
I've been asked to tell all you folks, if you are part of the bride and the groom's family, we ask you to stay here. They're going to take a few pictures, I think. And everybody else, you are dismissed to go to the reception, and they'll be over there with you in a minute. Thank you all for being here. God bless you.
I'm